Greetings, everybody. Back again. Now, the last one, that ended up being pretty short, thanks to titles like Lock Up and the Wormwood sequel not having required really a lot of discussion, all right? And of course, there was that whole throat thing. There was also definitely that. It got really bad later that night, so that worked out real well that I recorded that at all. But you can think of that video as the calm before the storm, because I'm looking at this little stack I have all set to go here, and I'm telling you right now, I'm going to need a lot of words. A lot. So settle in, because that makes this intro time. We're gonna leap out of the gates here with the 47 Ronin parts 1 and 2. Yes, indeed. Released in 1941 and 1942 for the second half, but not much seen in the West until the 1970s. That's a long time. This engaging and stirring epic was directed by the now legendary Kenji Mizoguchi, and he did it as a morale piece, even light propaganda, if you like. The thing is, it kind of failed miserably since, those were tough days for everybody, right? The timing was very rough for something like that. And now it seems to be thought of in weirdly dismissive terms by some. There are respected critics who have said, it's too long. It's too slow. It's too long and slow to be enjoyed as a real movie. I once read that this was, get this, too Japanese to be enjoyed by Western audiences. Now, I don't know if he meant that the way it sounded, but I'll tell you this, if I remembered who wrote it, I would name them here and I would shame them here, because that's not a good sentence. It's not a good sentiment, really. Still frustrates me that. Anyway, saying things along those lines only demonstrates ignorant disregard for a film that doesn't deserve it, for a director, for an entire culture and its entire history. If you don't like it, you don't like it. But I mean, come on. Too Japanese. Stop it. I don't want to veer too far off here, but it's just weird to me how masses of people can obsess over a whiny dwarf with a jewelry fetish for 9 straight hours. But this? Oh no, this is too much. Nope, can't have this. Ugh. But anyway, this story has been done and continues to be told again and again, all right? I feel like probably the most well-known an appreciated version in the West is Hiroshi Inagaki's Chushingira from 1962. It's really visually sumptuous and it stars Toshiro Mifune. So Chushingira, that's going to be the one most people have heard of if they have, right? There are a lot of other versions with that name, as a matter of fact, but that's probably the big one in the West. It's had a steady home video presence since VHS. And I just think it was kind of fated to be received more easily, right? This version was also on tape, but not together. You had to get them separate. So this DVD is kind, I feel. Very briefly, and then I'm going to continue to prattle a little bit. The tale is of a lord who is disgraced and ordered to commit seppuku. His loyal followers, they become masterless samurai, but they decide that their purpose will now be to avenge the completely wrongful death of their lord. Obviously, that's going to be a very simplified version, but there you go. I lack the verbal skills to do this movie justice, if we're being honest. There are themes and layers just so deep. it would take a better YouTuber than me to get into it. Even the cinematography, the design of the cinematography is just wow. Starting with the opening shots of each part, for example. I mean, you could go on and on. I won't, because like I said, I don't think I'm skillful enough to do it justice, but it's more than plausible and certainly worthwhile to do so for someone who's so inclined. I'm just not smart enough. Mizoguchi has fame, Western fame, I should say, for things like, Sancho the Bailiff, Ugetsu, titles like that. And it's not that it doesn't make sense that way, but my two favorite films of his that I've seen, I mean, the guy made over 150 movies after all, are very easily this and above this and all others, Utamaro and His Five Women. I think that's an absolute masterpiece. And that actually pairs well with this in a number of ways that aren't clearly, I don't know, on top. I mean, like feeling and pacing and actor presentation, like that. Here, it's like being on an almost 4 hour long art show presentation. And I feel that I've just lost some of you. But it's two movies, remember, it's two movies. His precision as director, it's so finessed, right? His clearly hyper-focused attention to detail and location and costume is just amazing. His slow but attentive and ever-revealing cinematography, it's just brilliant. It really is. It's fully immersive. I pop this sucker in and I am gone. It's another world. Yeah, it's Japanese history. Oh, that's still there. Okay, well. But Japanese history is so far removed from my personal experience that, it's just like walking into a dream. As I mentioned, it's been said it's too slow, and more than once. The same has been said of my favorite of his films, Utamaro. I don't feel that at all. Okay, nobody's wrong necessarily, but I want it on record that I strongly disagree. I don't think there are any wasted moments here at all. None. Everything has its place. The themes of honor and loyalty and love deep enough for sacrifice, all that is almost expected in classic samurai movie type stuff, I guess, and maybe even from this director, I suppose. But it's so profoundly explored and realized here that I don't understand how even people who don't care for it could possibly remain unimpressed. But different strokes, I guess, right? I wanted this when it came out on DVD, but being a image disc, it was a bit pricey for me at the time. I tried to wait for a deal, wait for a big sale or something, and it happened. It actually happened. I mixed that with a gift card that I had, and yeah, I actually got it. Problem is, I had to sell it way too soon after. I wasn't able to get it back until very recently. You guys know me by now. Had to be like new, but priced like the old days or better. And so it took a little while, right? But it happened. I've got it back now. So, this old print would hit some of you in the face like the Ark of the Covenant, okay? But I am still okay with it. I feel like we are already walking a weird line in some cases with over-cleaning things. Now, I don't want to start a whole thing, but I hope you guys know what I mean. Like, think about the earlier Code Red prints, for example. A lot of people complained about them, a lot of people thought it was perfect. I believe that's how a lot of those should look, or at the very least, it shouldn't be a problem. Very controversial. I'm getting controversial. But whatever. Seeing the occasional, whatever, mark for a real change or something, it's not even frontally conscious for me anymore. It's subconscious. It's just there. It's always been there. I grew up in theaters. I saw them in theaters. Watch on VHS. Forget about it. So I kind of like it. But like I said, I grew up with that. So yeah. Having said that, And I hope it came across the right way. I'm not sure it did, but I guess we'll see. This print is a little rough, even coming from that sort of place. And that's why I bothered to explain it in the first place. This, look, I would not have objected to some image stabilization, but maybe that's asking a lot, especially at the time, back then when they put it out. Probably even pricier then, and I mean, I don't know. It's the sound that needs the most help, I think. Like walking around with an AM radio up your ear. None of this hampers the ability to watch and enjoy this movie for me, which I do. However, if they put out a new version, I'll be the first in line. Okay, so yeah, just something to keep in mind if you are interested. And I do, I still enjoy it very much. Seeing it again after some years now, it still affects me the same way, all right? Which is powerfully. And I have several of the other cinematic tellings, and I enjoy them as well. Other versions come at the story from different angles or different character perspectives sometimes, right? But if you know Mizoguchi, then you know his touch is a different one. And yeah, it's just... Listen, I'm not recommending it to anybody who doesn't fully understand what they're getting into, right? If you know Mizoguchi but you haven't seen this, you should see this. If you don't, honestly, I don't know, because the reactions have been so weird to it from general critics and review sites, right? For me, a mandatory re-addition to the collection. I'm thrilled to have it again. I absolutely suggest looking up different versions or maybe even researching the actual events, which are obviously fascinating for a lot of reasons. Whatever you do, I did this. An old Image Snapper case DVD of Kenji Mizoguchi's The 47 Ronin. I hope I did it passable justice. I guess you can tell how happy having this sucker back makes me, right? 47 Ronin, parts 1 and 2. I told you guys I was going to have words. All right. So after that, lady and gentlemen, I give you Ozumpi. Yes, that's right. This is not a joke. This is not a drill. All right. Made in 2012. It's a mad movie full of masticating marauders. And it was directed by John Lide. Now, his name might not be familiar. It wasn't to me. But this guy is all up and down Hollywood in a big way. Look him up. It might blow your mind a little bit. It stars Danielle Churchman, now Ryan, Corey Sevier, William Rubio, Eva Morrow, Paul Hunt, and more. All right. So let me start like this. If you've never seen or heard of it, that first thought you had, that eye roll you probably did. Listen, I get it. I totally get it. I was the same way, right? But hang with me on this one for a bit, all right? So, a team of NATO Special Forces soldiers, they're on a mission to find and infiltrate a secret militia camp that is of special interest, all right? Along the way, zombies start popping up more and more and more the closer they get, okay? They also managed to pick up a woman who is on a search for her brother, who is also sneaked, who's also found his way into the area, okay? He's also looking for the camp. Jeez. So, sooner rather than later, all these people are joined together and must depend on each other if they're going to survive, much less accomplish the mission. Yes, look at it. That's the light summary, all right? Now, here's the part that's going to surprise most of you. This movie rocks, all right? It's a hell of a good time, all right? It's a rock and roll, fist-pumping, party animal of a balls-out action horror movie with tons of zombies, tons of carnage, splatter of both the practical and CG variety, rockets, guns, swords, yes, I said swords, and close quarters ass kicking. I'm not kidding. Right on. Okay, it's well directed. It looks outstanding, honestly. The cinematography is, it's outstanding. It's really good. The music's good. The acting's good. The script is good. And one problem movies like this seemed to be having for a little while was sort of forgetting that they were zombie movies. You know what I mean? This one does not. But it's got story and it's got heart. I'm not kidding you. I know some of you think you're waiting for the punchline. I'm not kidding. It's exciting and it's funny. Everything's great. I'm not kidding. I'm really not kidding. There's a lot of characterization, all well-timed and well-placed. And all of a sudden you find out you care about these people, all right? Maybe a bit heavy on the CG splatter, but if you go in expecting anything different post-2000s, then that's on you, not the movie, right? So yeah, at the beginning, the story we all know sort of happens, kind of. And out the helicopter and this and that, but there's a variation on that. But before the credits even, I think, Ozombie is walking out of the waves to eat some young lovers, and we are off and running. All Anthropophagus style there. Turns out there was some chemical experimentation also going on. It's all explained well in the movie, but so I won't get into it, but that's what caused this. So, yeah, man, that's the shocker of the update, I guess. This movie is badass. It's got like a 3-something on IMDb, but skip that and read some of the reviews left by people who clearly actually watched it. They liked it more often than not, and that's the trick, okay? They were also surprised. I'm not sure the semi-jokey name did this thing any favors, honestly, but it doesn't change how entertaining and well put together this sucker is, right? I recommend it. I really do. Check out the trailer, all right? I'm sure you will do that push-mouth, eyebrow-raising thing that happens during happy surprises that makes some people look like they're doing Robert De Niro impersonations. That thing, you'll make that face. It's a lot of fun, and it was a very real surprise. I judged it a bit harshly as well ahead of time. That's why it took me so long to see it. Since then, I've now seen it twice and counting. Good times. Check it out. It's Ozombie. Oh, yeah. And it also comes with a slipcase if you're willing to pay a few more bucks. It's exactly this, though. So, either way, do check it out. And if you do, leave a comment because I'm very curious. Ozombie. How about that? How about A Little Love and Sword from 1979, starring Tien Ping, sometimes known as Rock Tien, in the role of his career, I think, maybe. I'd have to think about it, but I think so. And Tang Pao Yun as the female lead in her second to last role before passing away. Lots of recognizable faces throughout, like Dean Shek, Danny Chow, others. It was directed by Yu Kang Ping and is on DVD here, thanks to Hoker Entertainment. But more on that in a moment. All right, so this one starts with the midnight massacre of a kung fu master and his family, except for his blind daughter. As the assassins leave the villa, Tien Ping watches them go and heads inside, curious only to find the carnage and the blind daughter crying alone and afraid. He takes her away and quickly sets out to assassinate all those involved with the murder slash massacre to revenge for the daughter who cannot. However, there are many who would like him stopped, of course, and not just for the obvious reasons either. And there are those to seek to take him out because he's gaining such a huge reputation and they want to kill him for their own fame. Others want to kill him for a reward, stuff like that. There's a lot of people after him. Things get very complicated very quickly. And there's even more to it than that, of course, but you won't hear about it from me. All right, listen, I was thinking of proper adjectives to use for this one. I really was ahead of time. And things like lavish, and I wanted to use words like spectacle. But actually, I'm going to skip all that because the movie deserves more than that. More than patented cliches, right? It's bigger than that, and it's better than that. There were a couple times when I even thought to myself, wow, if somebody argued hard enough that Choi Hark had something to do with this, I'd probably believe it. Twice that happened. Twice I thought of that. That's how high-reaching this movie is, all right? It's just outstanding. The story is great. Same cover. The actors are great. And oh, baby, that sword play. Wow. I mean, yeah. It's an outstanding movie all the way around. It even gets a bit Shakespearean at the end. I won't say more than that, but I did want to indicate the level of pain, loss, and absolute misery that are present. So, there you go. Cool. Now, this was released on Ocean Shores VHS as The Samurai. I had that, and I'm not sure if I ever showed it anywhere or in an update. I don't know. But the tape wasn't so great, and then it was worse than that, and it's gone now. This Hoker DVD, listen, they aren't ever going to win awards, but fully letterboxed and subtitled, yeah, I'm in. Okay? This is also available as Love and Sword from Rarescope. Ah, I've talked to a couple of friends who have it, and I get the idea the prints are similar, if not maybe exactly the same. I went with Hoker because, as some of you might remember, I was really into getting Hoker releases for a little while. I was on a real kick with those. And even though I also had kind of a kick with the Rarescope stuff, this is the way I went. That art right there kind of put me over the top, believe it or not. Thought it was really cool. It's been a long time since I got a Hoker release. Happy to have it. Comes down to personal preference, really. You have options. That's the important point. And yeah, just another unheralded late 70s filmed in Taiwan masterpiece of martial arts cinema. That's all. I recommend it very highly. It's high-level entertainment. Those fight scenes, just awe-inspiring. Oh, I don't know if you can see that clearly, but it does indicate that it's anamorphic in the bottom. It's not. But the subtitles are in the picture, so you hit zoom and all is well. Love and Sword. Do check this one out. Great stuff. It's about time to what? Get crazy. Too easy. But yeah, get crazy. Finally on Blu, thanks to the mighty Kino Lorber. This 1983 cult classic, still waiting to find its audience, was directed by Alan Arkush and stars. You know what? Never mind. I'll just run down a bunch of names later. I got them in my notes. It's fine. So, the plot is an excuse for this movie to live. All right? It's not deep, but you won't notice. It's about a huge concert taking place on New Year's Eve, 1982 to 1983. And the theater where it's happening is apparently a legendary place of musical history, etc. Now, there's an evil scumbag trying to buy out the theater for personal profit and something he wants to build on the property or some such nonsense. And he's the guy who wants to rip the heart out of rock and roll in the story, okay? So we boo him and his cronies. Of course, when he doesn't get his way, he decides he's just gonna take the place down. He's not gonna be disrespected like that, and that's that. But what we get here is okay, You know what? If you mixed Caddyshack FM and Airplane in a blender, this is what would come out. Seriously, I think that's about dead on, really. And like those movies, it's a real movie, right? It's got locations and actors and stunts and special effects and car action and romance and fully gratuitous nudity and explosions. And yeah, it's just awesome. You know, I'm always pointing out how effed up IMDb is with movies I love, right? This one, even on IMDb, has a rating now pushing 7 out of 10, right? That's pretty impressive. The thing is, it only has about 1,200 votes, and that's the whole deal with this one. This thing is so underseen, it's painful. Oh my God, it's right side up. Look at that. But when you find people who have seen it, most of the time, you know, they will tell you how much they love it and how great it is. Now, maybe this thing can find the audience it has always deserved. I hope it does. It's just a blast and a half. It's wild, it's fast, always entertaining, never chaotic, so that it becomes just loud and you get annoyed, right? It's not that kind of movie. Controlled mayhem, all right? Perfect pacing, no fat, just a fun movie. I can almost guarantee, almost, that this is the best movie featuring Malcolm McDowell with a talking penis that you're ever gonna see in your life. All right? So you can take that to the bank. Right, the cast. Look, I took the notes. Get this. All right, let me read them off for you. Daniel Stern, Gail Edwards, as I mentioned, Malcolm McDowell and friend. He's doing sort of a Mick Jagger thing. And there's another band that's kind of doing a Grateful Dead kind of thing. You know, it's everybody's doing their own version of something. Stacy Nelkin is in it, who you'll know from Halloween 3, among others. But you know, Halloween 3, the finest sequel of the bunch. Oh, another hot take. All right. That's right. Alan Garfield, Franklin Ajai, who, I mean, maybe best known for Car Wash, maybe, I don't know. But he's been around. He's in it. Ed Begley Jr. I mean, he's everywhere. Lou Reed. Yep, Lou Reed. Lee Ving, Mary Warrenoff, Paul Bartel, Dick Miller cameos, of course, as does Clint Howard. And was that Linnea Quigley? It definitely was. And more. Actually, I'm not going to name them all. Spotting all the faces is part of the fun. There's a bunch of them to see here. But I will give an honorable mention to Electric Larry, the best friend you never knew you needed. Right on, Electric Larry. So, yeah, there's a lot to talk about, and there are a lot of references. But if you haven't seen it, of course, I'm not going to ruin any of that here. You should just see it. Seriously, it's long overdue to be appreciated for the first time. I think now's the time. There's a beautiful blue. Check it out. Spread the word. There are extras, plenty of extras, commentary, featurettes, documentary, trailers, music videos, fan fiction video of a kind. I mean, yeah, there's lots to enjoy. It goes on sale often. It's get crazy. And it's about time you did, right? Moving right along, we've got Gold Diggers of 1933 on Blu-ray as part of the Warner Archive Collection, as you can see there. Directed by Mervyn LeRoy with an all-star cast, which I'll get to later, and with numbers designed and realized by Busby Berkeley himself. There are a few Gold Diggers movies. I believe this was the second one. Correct me if I got that wrong. But it goes like this. A visionary producer, Broadway producer. He's got everything he needs for his next show and his guaranteed success, except the money to put the show on. Times are tough, right? So, thanks to one of the girls who he plans to cast as one of the leads in his new show, he meets an aspiring composer who he instantly wants to use in the show. He's instantly in love with what the guy does. when the bit about not having the money comes up, this would-be musician promises he'll come up with the money. Everybody scoffs, tells him that it's cruel, it's a cruel joke, don't do it. But of course, it happens, which then casts quite a bright and mysterious light on this new-to-the-area guy, of course. So there's much more to his story than anybody knows about, which is especially tough on that soon-to-be lead girl who has fallen in love with him. All right, it's not what you think, if you haven't seen it, but there are things to know, of course. And once the truth is out, well, I mean, yeah, that brings a whole new set of complications, right? Still, the show does go on, but will it stay on? That's the plot. Now, any gold digger's plot is, you know, it's not something you would refer to as intellectually taxing or anything, but it has some layers. It's got some stuff going on. It's a good one, right? A lot of times it ends up just being a variation of, but we've got to put the show on, and not much else. And there's nothing wrong with that, honestly. Still, this one has more, and that's great. Now, the cast. Oh, man, oh man. So you got Ruby Keeler and Dick Powell. They play the young lovers, but you also get Joan Blondell, who is really, really good here. I was really impressed. You get Ginger Rogers. You get Guy Kibbe, Warren William, and quite a few other faces in bigger and smaller roles. Classic film fans will surely recognize as it goes on. And you even get Billy Barty, when he was very young, as a troublemaking toddler at a park during a decidedly pre-code bit of business, sure to raise a few eyebrows, all right? The next time you watch Roger Rabbit, see if you can guess which character he inspired. Hint, it's painfully obvious. You'll know. So, overall, this is just a huge middle finger to the Depression in general, all right? Which was really peaking right at this time. The grand and lavish production, is that lavish word again? But it's accurate. Though acknowledging the troubles of the world was clearly meant to provide some generally upbeat escapism for the most part. However, and this is the part that I think makes this movie really, really stand out from everything else of the time, the last number is a full-on gut punch. It really is. And that's what the movie leaves you in, and that's crazy. Still manages to resonate emotionally today. So I can't imagine the effect it would have had back then under those circumstances. I imagine whole audiences leaving the theaters just broken and in tears. Wouldn't surprise me at all. And speaking of numbers, okay, Busby Berkeley, man. So it opens with, you know, his big We're in the Money, partially presented in Pig Latin for reasons I'm sure I'll never fully understand. But okay, you know, whatever. And one of the big numbers towards the end features girls with violins and bows that light up in the dark. His penchant for the human kaleidoscope stuff is on display. And truly, it's jaw-dropping. It's so good. Leroy and Berkeley really just had it together, and they left it all on stage, as it were. So much creativity and imagination. I can't say enough great things about that stuff. So brightly realized and so impressive. Great. Then it was great. Now it's great. It's always going to be great. All right. This blue replaces the disc for me. Hold on. Let me grab that. It's right here. No pauses this time. I was ready-ish. So there's the disc, right? The old disc, which is part of this collection. All right. Which you've seen pop up before a couple of times at this point. I hope to finish replacing it in the near future. That's kind of up to Warner, though, isn't it? But yeah, as long as they keep putting them out, I'll keep grabbing them. This movie, it shows up on best of the 30s lists a lot, or must-see movies, that kind of thing. And it's interesting to see how many movies Berkeley was involved with make those lists over and over again. But this one's almost always on there. And this is a great-looking blue, all right? And there are a bunch of fun and interesting extras, which I will show here. And that's about it, I suppose. Obviously, a very strong recommendation for classic film fans. Always moving, always entertaining, and oh man, those spectacular set pieces. Wow. It's Gold Diggers of 1933. It's almost 90 years old. I'd say it's about time you checked it out, right? Hey, we did it. We did it. We got through another one. That was a pretty wild mix that time. And it's fun when I can do that. So, all right, the bad news first. I don't think the next update is going to happen at all. The one that would come 2 weeks from now. It's out of my control. And I will give it a try. But if you were going to bet, I'd tell you to bet against it. Seriously. After that, things should be fine, but I think the next one is probably going to have to get skipped. Sorry about that. But as I said, it's absolutely out of my control. I can't do anything about it. I will try to fight it. I just don't think I'm going to be able to make it happen. The good news is that I'll be able to pick 5 random titles like this again out of, what, a month of viewing? Should turn out to be another fascinating and or bizarre mix, depending on your point of view, I guess. Maybe it's both. And yeah, that's all I got. So that'll do it. Please like and comment and all that stuff I'm always asking for. Hit the bell, hit subscribe, all that great stuff. I do appreciate it. It means a lot. And I will see you in the next one. Later.